President Muhammadu Buhari has condemned the killing of Reverend Lawan Andimi by Boko Haram terrorists. In a series of tweets on Tuesday, the president described the murder of the clergyman as inhuman and vowed to ensure the insurgents pay dearly for their actions. Reverend Andimi, who was abducted by Boko Haram terrorists in early January, was the chairman of the Christian Association of Nigeria, CAN, in Michika local government area of Adamawa State. He was murdered by his captors on Monday, despite calls for his release by various groups, including the national leadership of the Christian body. President Buhari, however, condoled with the family of the slain reverend, the Christian community across the country, as well as the government and people of Adamawa State. Now, joining me in the studio is public affairs analyst Gbolahan Olojede to make sense of all of this. Good morning. And good to have you. Now we have heard yet another killing, you know, from the terrorist group. My first question would be, how do we get out of this terrorist abduction and killing situation?
It's a fairly complex thing. That is why it has stayed for this long. Of course, the federal government has been trying to bomb them out of their holes, kill the people they can kill, arrest people that could be arrested. But we have also consistently seeing them attacking soft targets, someone wearing bombs and going into the market and blowing herself up in the market. Then all these abductions demand for, they also require funding. So they do these abductions, demand for money, and they get money to fund whatever activities that is going on there. So it is now fairly complex, but no matter how complex it has become, we must finally root them out totally. As it is not enough that they are technically, in the words of the federal government, technically defeated.
Whatever that
but,
means.
But, you know, technically could be that they don't have that capacity for what they used to do, coming to bomb Yanyan, coming to bomb, you know, police headquarters and all those kind of things. They probably don't have those kind of powers any longer. But as long as the lives of the citizens are still in jeopardy, as long as we still have roads that people are scared to pass through, as long as kidnaps still continues, then it's not over until it is actually over.
And that takes me to my second question. Before we heard of this death, we saw the video clip of the late Reverend Andimi pleading for help from the government, you know, from the Christian community, from the governor of that state, you know, asking that they please intervene. Now, how easy is it to negotiate with these people? And is that really, I mean, the terrorists now, is that an option? Is that the best option that we do have?
Well, it's a fair, like I said, this terrorism matter is a fairly complex thing. You've seen a situation in which some country will say, I will not negotiate with a terrorist. A couple of years down the line, that same country will negotiate with terrorists and to get some people out. So that's why I said the dynamics are not, they're not cast in stone, they're not firm. You just have to take each situation as it comes. In this particular case, it will appear to me that it wasn't even the federal government that was doing the negotiation. It seems as if it's maybe his CAN or his own people that were doing the negotiation. Which also brings to the fact that, the table the fact that we know we have contact with them.
We can put a face to
this.
We
can put a face, in a way, to at least the leadership. Or otherwise, how are we doing these negotiations? If we can have these individual negotiations, can we actually do a body, can we bring the body itself to a table and see how we can talk it out about this? Because I don't think the military is enough to deal with an ideology. You can kill and kill and kill. And then as long as those things reside in the minds of those people, it's very sad. Now, this gentleman, despite the plea, has been killed. And what that, the implication of that is that, look, if it was an ordinary person again that was kidnapped, we probably would just, it would just be a number. Somebody was kidnapped. But it became big because it was a CAN leader in that area. So that's a high value target. It exposes the Christians further because when you kidnap a Christian, you generate more attention for yourself. You probably can bid higher. Let me tell you something that might happen. God forbid that there's another one like this. If there's another one like this, they won't even be talking of the 50 million. Because they know the people will panic. Mm-hmm. You know that even if you offer me 50 million, I can still kill that target. So they can shoot for something much higher. And that is why I said it puts the Christian further in jeopardy, because they have become high-value target that will generate the necessary attention and I can raise the necessary funding that they want.
I will ask a follow-up question to that, but before then, let's take a look at some graphics and put this in context, in terms of, you know, people that we hear deaths and over time. Now, we have some graphics from the Nigeria Security Tracker. I believe it will be put up. And if we look, it will be put up, I believe, we'll see the movement from 2013 up until 2020, the killings that we've seen in terms of Boko Haram. It's already displayed there. And when we look at that graphics, it says that the total deaths, according to Nigeria Security Tracker, is about 36,000 people that have died. And we've seen the movement, you know, from 2013, we saw the increase in between 2014 and 2015, and then 2019 to 2020. So it means that we are still having the same conversation. And yet another graphics, they also displayed the movement, how the numbers are increasing. Every other year, we see, even here, we saw from 2012 and then 2016, there's a major shoot up, and then up until 2019, and then 2020, which is just the beginning of the year. Now, where I'm going with this graphics, this display, is for us to see, when we talk about these deaths, to see how it's moving, the movement. And again, we've heard Mr. President saying he's condemned this act, which we hear that almost every other time. And he says he's vowed to ensure the insurgents pay dearly for their actions. Now, having seen these graphics, having seen, you know, even being in Nigeria and seeing how these things happen, is this enough? Is that the solution to the problem we have at hand?
If you look at those plots, you will see the spikes are quite obvious. And you also see when it went down, and it sort of leveled up in a way. It flattened out a little bit. And that is the effect of the so-called technical defeat. So it means that they can't go into a place and blow up 300 people any longer and all of that. But it didn't disappear. It just flattened a little bit. So which is this issue of soft target and victims like Lawan and Dimi and all the other victims that are still there. These are the vestiges that must be found. Because when you look at the total number, it is scary.
It says,
this is 36,000 people.
And we have an issue of data in this country. So this is the one we can say from Nigeria Security Tracker as what we have. I bet to say that it just might be more than this.
It might be. It might be more than this. Mm-hmm. Collecting data, even in places that are not war-torn zones, is a challenge. Talk of a war front is a major challenge. Mm-hmm. And the fact that the vestiges are still there, the technical defeat is no longer enough for the people. It's not placating any longer. So we need to, just like the president has promised once again, get to even those vestiges and finally put a stop.
He has vowed. He said he's vowed to ensure. So
it's not about
how long
vowing.
Is it going to take?
Vowing and making promises, it's right. It tends to assure the citizen that, oh, the leader is doing something about it. But they want it to translate to actual total defeat. They don't want a situation in which tomorrow you hear again that some soft target have been kidnapped again.
All right.
That's the issue.
Okay, we'll just take a final question, which is the follow-up question that I said I was going to ask you. You see, you mentioned that because of the person that's involved, so this is like huge, so
it
to
is.
Speak. Not like the others are not important. Every life matters in this country.
Correct.
My question is, because even as he is killed, you know, the paper and the media also has it that another pastor was killed whose name we don't know. So are we seeing some sort of religious crisis, or so to speak, for lack of a better word? Is that where this is?
I understand what you're saying. In my opinion, the terrorists understand the fault lines of Nigeria thoroughly. And if they can ride it they will ride it very well. And I see elements of that in what they are currently doing. When you have those religious coloration to criminality, it creates a new body of sentiment totally. And it gains much more attention than what it would have been if it was just left without those ethnic colorations. So we, as a nation, we have to be very careful about the religious dimensions, because even in societies where, if you go to the Middle East part, you know, where there are also this terrorism, even in societies where population is like 90-something, 98-99% Muslims, terrorism is still there. Mm-hmm. All right. We have to be careful.
We have to be careful. Yes. Thank you very much, Mr. Olojede there.